Today we are looking at, if you only knew. His name was Flavius Valerius Aurelia Constantinus Augustus. History calls him Constantine the Great. Out of the 103 individuals, monarchs, kings, queens, czars, popes, out of 103 individuals who were nicknamed the Great, Constantine is one. Does Constantine deserve such a nickname? Well, Constantine, when he became Emperor of Rome, he would be Emperor of Rome for some 30-odd years. And when he became emperor, he decided he didn't like Rome. He wanted a better located capital. So he decided to build his own. One that would be right there in Asia, where Asia and Europe come together. There on the Mediterranean and have a great port. And so he built a city, and he said it would surpass what Rome had ever been before. Built the city, he called it Constantinople. Today we know it as Istanbul. And he must have known what he was talking about, because for the next 700 years, Constantinople was the largest city in the world. Great. Constantine, when he became emperor, he also wanted a library. He wanted it to rival, surpass the library in Alexandria, which at that moment was the greatest library on earth. So he built himself a library in Constantinople. And for the next 1,000 years, he was the largest library in the world. It had over 100,000 volumes. Great. Constantine also, when he became emperor of Rome, as often emperors did, he produced, he minted, he circulated his own money, his own coins. Now, like I said, many emperors did that. Plastered their face, all of the coins. Constantine the Great did the same thing. Only his money continued to be minted, his face continued to be circulated for 1,200 years. To have your money circulated 1,200 years after your death. Great? One more thing about Constantine. Did you know Constantine was the very first Roman emperor to convert to Christianity? Very first. Now, many historians suggest that he did it purely for political reasons, and his heart clearly was not in it. Others suggest that his mother, Helena, had a great influence on her son, Constantine. Helena had become a devout Christian. And so many historians say she influenced her son to be converted. For sure, they collaborated on an unbelievable project in the Holy Land. They decided that after Helena made a pilgrimage to the Holy Land, that they would come up with a way to protect the holy sites of the Holy Land. How can we do this? And Helena and Constantine decided that they would build churches over holy sites throughout the Holy Land. And thus it is, we have a church of the Nativity. And we have a church of the Holy Sepulchre. We have the Church of Transfiguration. We have the Church or Basilica of Agony there on the Mount of Olives in the spot there in Gethsemane that is claimed that Jesus prayed the night he was arrested. And because of Helena and because of Constantine bankrolling the entire project, there is also a church that is built over a site that we know as Jacob's Well. That's rather interesting. Jacob's Well. By the way, today is a Greek Orthodox. Jesus feed 5,000 people at Jacob's well? Did he raise Lazarus from the dead there at Jacob's well? Did you know that in the entire Bible, all of Scripture, that Jacob's well is only mentioned one time by name? Just one. And yet Constantine had a church built there to protect Jacob's well. No, he didn't feed 5,000 people there. Jesus did not raise anybody from the dead there. What he did have at Jacob's well was a conversation. And it is considered one of the greatest conversations the world has ever recorded. A conversation between an unnamed Samaritan woman and a Jewish man named Jesus. Now that in itself would make news. Of course, this Jewish man named Jesus is also the Son of God. Open your Bibles or take the bulletins. We've got the text that we're using on the Bible. John chapter 4. Today we are looking at If You Only Knew. John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6, as we begin to take a look at this conversation that was so important that Constantine built a church over Jacob's well. John chapter 4, beginning with verse 1. Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, but he needed to go through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. We know that Jesus and his disciples had left Judea earlier that day. They were traveling north to the province of Galilee. Jesus may have been the only Jew on the planet to travel from Judea to Galilee by traveling through Samaria. If you were a good Jew, you didn't do it. You went the long way. You went up by the Jordan River. You didn't go through Samaria because guess what? It was full of Samaritans. And just a shout made you spiritually unfit. Just a shadow cast upon you, you are undoing. And so most Jews took the long route, but not Jesus. Jesus and the 12 arrived at the Samaritan village of Sychar around noon. The town had been going into lunch mode, into siesta time. You see, they had a siesta. They called it the heat of the day, where they shut down for an hour or two. Jesus and the 12 had picked Sychar as a rest stop, maybe to get some food. Jacob's well was about a 6-minute walk from the entrance, from the gate to the city of Sychar. Now, Jacob's well, as far as water collection, water was collected twice a day. You collected water in the morning and in the evening. You would have a line of women with their clay pots on their heads traversing from Jacob's, from the city to Jacob's well and back again, early in the morning and late in the evening. Nobody was supposed to get water during the evening. So Jesus, as he decides, I will stay here. You guys go in town, get some food. Jesus should, under normal circumstances, he should be the only one to do it. But remarkably, on this particular day, a woman named 4, again, beginning of verse 7. Reading through verse 9, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And indeed, the lady was describing the sociological reality of her day. For she is baffled by this Jew's approach. A Jewish man accepting water from the hand of a Samaritan woman. Well, she seemed to all this. If she lives to be 100, she'll never be able to see something like this again. Jesus dismisses the sociological issue that the Samaritan woman brings up. His response, John 4, verse 10. Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew." If you only knew. If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, "Give me a drink," you would have asked him, and he would have given you the living water. Jesus tells the woman, "If you only knew." Our message today, if you only knew. You know, we often repeat the phrase, "If I only knew." If I had only known, I would have done it differently. If I only knew then what I know now. We say that all the time. Years ago, I was driving from Bristol, Tennessee, down to Wilkesboro, North Carolina, there on 421. I think that's about a 90-minute trip. The road is not all that good. About the time I got to the Carolina border, I got behind an 18-wheeler hauling chickens. It's tough to pass. But finally, after mile after mile after mile, an opening came up. And I floored it, and I went around this chicken truck. I had plenty of time to get back in line. But I didn't know that the oncoming vehicle was a state trooper. What are the odds that I choose to pass at the exact time I get back on my side of the road and coming in the opposite direction in front of a state trooper? That sure enough, he zips around. Pulls a 360 and comes after me, pulls me over. Gives me a ticket because he said I had sped up to 64 as I was passing the truck in the time. I thought it was a little over the top, but he didn't see it my way. Proceeded to give me a ticket. If I only knew, Scott, that the very first car coming in the opposite direction was a state trooper, if I had only known, do you think I would have passed? I had to pay a heavy fine, my insurance doubled, and on top of everything else, because this was the third speeding ticket I had gotten in a very short period of time, they said, "Either you give us your license for the next year, or you go to something called traffic school." Have you ever been to traffic school? Those of you know me, when I say this, you know it's serious. I would almost rather eat a bowl of grits than go to traffic school. I mean, the worst thing on earth is grits, but the second worst thing is traffic school. If I only that a state trooper was coming in the other direction, I'd have stayed behind the chicken truck and not passed. So, if I only had known. Jesus tells the Samaritan woman, "If you only knew, If she knew two things, Jesus said, it would change her world. Turn her world upside down. Number one, Jesus said, if you know who you were talking to, if you knew who it was that you were in conversation with, and secondly, if you only knew what I could do for you, if you know those two things, if you knew, it would turn your world upside down. By the way, there's nothing greater. Nothing greater on the face of the earth than having Jesus turn your world upside down.
Amen.
Jesus is the only one. Jesus suggests that not knowing these two things, knowing him and knowing what he can do for her, is causing the woman to miss out on a better life. Now some might suggest, well, it's better if you don't know it. Right? After all, you're only responsible for the parts you know. That's a fool's errand to live our lives on the less you know, the better off you are for it. That's a dangerous approach to it. Jesus did not say, the less truth you know, the better off you are. Instead, Christ claimed, abide in my word and you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The more truth you know, the better off you are. The more you know, the better. Jesus said, if you only knew. So, lady, why don't you go fetch your husband and we'll talk about it. She said, well, I don't have a husband. Jesus said, wait a minute. But you have been married 5 times. And the man you're with presently, he is not your husband. And I noticed that you came to fetch water when no one else comes. So tell me, lady, are you cool with your life as it stands? Or do you want to know these two things? I tell you, if a lady was wearing socks that day, Jesus knocked her socks off with that conversation. More than likely, she was barefooted. But what he did knock off was that clay pitcher right off of her head. Because she said, I haven't got time for that thing. She leaves it there. Runs back to the city of Sychar. Our message today, if you only knew. You know, there are a lot of sevens in the book of Revelation. Seven seals on the scroll, seven angels and seven trumpets. Seven stars, seven horns, seven eyes, seven thunders, seven heads with seven crowns, seven plagues, and yes, seven churches. Now, on the one hand, these seven churches are very good. Real locations on the map in Asia. We know for certain, though, that there are more than these seven churches in Asia when Jesus shares the thoughts of Revelation with his disciple John. But Jesus, he handpicks these seven so that they can also be seen in a symbolic manner representing the lifespan of the Christian church. And Christ picks the character of the members of the church in the Asian city of Laodicea to symbolically represent the last day church, which is us. Revelation 3:14-17. To the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things say the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither cold or hot. I can miss you are cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth, because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not what?
No.
You don't know. See, the real problem with Laodicea is not that she's sinful. That's a given. Every church has been. Yes, the last day church has its problems. But you know what Jesus says? I can fix problems. You're blind? I can fix it. Naked? I can fix it. Poor? I can fix it. But if you choose not to live, then there's no problem. If you're only new, Laodicea, if you only knew, Jesus is addressing his end of days church. Not so much to complain about her sins, but to complain that the glaring problem is that we are needy and we don't know. It's remarkable. The same lesson that Jesus has for the Samaritan woman in Jacob's well matches perfectly with his lesson to the end of days church. Same message. If you only knew me and that I could fix you. You know, most people. When the first century church leaders finally had Jesus right where they wanted him, nailed to a tree, they rub it in. The Bible tells us that they have a rather good time rubbing the nose of Jesus into the fact that, well, you're up there and we're not. Jesus is there on the cross. And if they would have had the Price is Right show, I'm not even sure that David show is still on TV, but the famous line from Price is Right, "Come on down, Jesus." We believe that. Come on down. Oh, they had a good time. And you know who was watching the Jewish leaders pay particularly close attention to the criminal Jesus? The Roman soldiers. The detachment of soldiers that had been assigned to crucifying these three criminals. They watched and they watched and they watched as the Jews piled on this man, Jesus. They're lost before they join in the fight. And they add their cruel comments. They add their jokes. It's not lost on Jesus. Jesus realizes that the soldiers have joined in with the cruel insults of the Jewish leaders. Jesus addresses the situation. And with these words, "Father, forgive them, for they what? They don't know." Our message, if you only knew, Jesus, forgive them. I wish they knew. These Roman soldiers in particular, if they only knew who it was on this cross and that he could change the world, not only for this temporary existence, but for eternity. Change it. Those two things that Jesus told the Samaritan woman, he tells us. Number one, if you knew it, Jesus says, if you would only know this, and if you knew what I could do for you, it was turn your world upside down. You want to have Jesus turn your world upside down.
Amen.
That's right. If you only knew.